I have a friend who's an artist, and he's sometimes taken a view which I don't agree with very well. He'll hold up a flower and say, look how beautiful it is. And I'll agree. And he says, you see, as I as an artist can see how beautiful this is, but you as a scientist, oh, take this all apart and it becomes dull thing. And I think that he's kind of nutty. First of all, the beauty that he sees is available to other people and to me too. I believe, although I may not be quite as refined as aesthetically as he is, that I can appreciate the beauty of a flower. At the same time, I see much more about the flower than he sees. I could imagine the cells in there, the complicated actions inside, which also have a beauty. I mean, it's not just beauty at this dimension of 1 centimeter, there's also beauty at a smaller dimensions. The inner structure, also the processes, the fact that the colors and the flower evolved in order to attract insects to pollinate it is interesting. It means that insects can see the color. It adds a question. Does this aesthetic sense also exist in the lower forms? Why is it aesthetic? All kinds of interesting questions which the science knowledge only adds to the excitement, the mystery, and the awe of a flower. It only adds. I don't understand how it subtracts. If you expected science to give all the answers to the wonderful questions about what we are, where we're going, what the meaning of the universe is, and so on, then I think you could easily become disillusioned and then look for some mystic answer to these problems. How a scientist can take a mystic answer, I don't know, because the whole spirit is to understand. Well, never mind that. I don't understand that. But anyhow, if you think of it, though, the way I think of what we're doing is we're exploring. We're trying to find out as much as we can about the world. People say to me, are you looking for the ultimate laws of physics? No, I'm not. I'm just looking to find out more about the world. And if it turns out there is a simple ultimate law that explains everything, so be it. That would be very nice to discover. If it turns out it's like an onion with millions of layers and we're just sick and tired of looking at the layers, then that's the way it is. But whatever way it comes out, its nature is there and she's going to come out the way she is. And therefore, when we go to investigate it, we shouldn't pre-decide what it is we're trying to do except to find out more about it. You see, one thing is I can live with doubt and uncertainty and not knowing. I think it's much more interesting to live not knowing than to have answers which might be wrong. I have approximate answers and possible beliefs and different degrees of certainty about different things, but I'm not absolutely sure of anything, and the many things I don't know anything about. But I don't have to know an answer. I don't feel frightened by not knowing things, by being lost in the mysterious universe without having any purpose, which is the way it really is, as far as I can tell, possibly. It doesn't frighten me. And so altogether, I can't believe the special stories that have been made up about our relationship to the universe at large, because they seem to be too simple, too connected, too local, too provincial. The Earth, he came to the Earth. One of the aspects of God came to the Earth, mind you. And look at what's out there. How can it isn't in proportion. Anyway, it's no use arguing. I can't argue it. I'm just trying to tell you, with the scientific view, well, my father's view, that we should look to see what's true and what maybe may not be true. Once you start doubting, which I think is, to me is a very fundamental part of my soul, is to doubt. And to ask. And when you doubt and ask, it gets a little harder to believe. But one of the things that my father taught me beside physics, whether it's correct or not, was a disrespect for respectable, for certain kinds of things. For example, he used to sit me again on his knee, and he'd open a picture, and there was a picture of the Pope with everybody bowing in front of him. And he'd say, now look at these humans, he'd say. Here's one human standing here, and all these others are bowing. Now what is the difference? This one is the Pope, and those are the ordinary people. He hated the Pope anyway. And he'd say, the difference is epaulettes, of course, not in the case of the Pope. Maybe it was a general. It was always the uniform, the position, that this man has the same human problems. He eats dinner like anybody else. He goes to the bathroom. He has the same kind of problems as everybody. He's a human being. Why are they all bowing to him? Only because of his name and his position, because of his uniform, not because of something he especially did.
Was it worth the Nobel Prize?
I don't know anything about the Nobel Prize. I don't understand what it's all about or what's worth what. And if the people in the Swedish Academy decide that X, Y, or Z wins the Nobel Prize, then so be it. I won't have anything to do with the Nobel Prize. It's a pain in the... I don't like honors. I appreciate it for the work that I did, and for people who appreciate it, and I notice that other physicists use my work. I don't need anything else. I don't think there's any sense to anything else. I don't see that it makes any point that someone in the Swedish Academy decides that this work is noble enough to receive a prize. I've already got the prize. The prize is the pleasure of finding the thing out, the kick in the discovery, the observation other people use it. Those are the real things. The honors are unreal to me. I don't believe in honors. It bothers me. Honors bothers me. Honors as epaulettes. Honors as uniforms. My papa brought me up this way. I can't stand it. It hurts me. When I was in high school, one of the first honors I got was to be a member of the Arista, which is a group of kids who got good grades. And everybody wanted to be a member of the Arista. And when I got into the Arista, I discovered that what they did in their meetings was to sit around to discuss who else was worthy to join this wonderful group that we are. Okay, so we sat around trying to decide who it was who would get to be allowed into this Arista. This kind of thing bothers me psychologically for one or another reason. I don't understand myself. Honors have, from that day to this, always bothered me. Okay, I don't like honors.
The whole universe is very strange. But see, when you look at the details and you find out that the rules are very simple of the game, the mechanical rules by which you can figure out exactly what's going to happen when the situation is simple. It's again this chess game business. If you were in just a corner where only a few pieces are involved, you can work out exactly what should happen. And you can always do that when there's only a few pieces. And so you know you understand it. And yet, in the real game, it's so many pieces you can't figure out what's going to happen. So there was a kind of hierarchy of different complexities. It's hard to believe. It's incredible. In fact, most people don't believe that the behavior of, say, me, Juan Yak-Yak, and you, Noddy, and all this stuff, is the result of lots and lots of atoms all obeying these very simple rules. Come out that it evolves into such a creature that the billion years of life with its experiences has produced the thing with prongs that stick out like this and so on. There's such a lot in the world, there's so much distance between the fundamental rules and the final phenomena that it's almost unbelievable that the final variety of phenomena can come from such a steady operation of such simple rules.
But you had to build the most complex scaffolding to find out the simple rules.
But it is not complicated. It's just a lot of it. And if you'd start at the beginning, which nobody wants to do, I mean, you come in to me now in an interview and you're asking me about the latest discoveries of the day. Nobody ever asks about a simple, ordinary phenomenon in the street. Oh, like, what about those colors? Or something like that. We have a nice interview and explain all about the colors. Butterfly wings, whole big deal. You don't care about that. You want the big final result. Then it's going to be complicated because I am at the end of a 400 years a very effective method of finding things out about the world. It has to do with curiosity. It has to do with people wondering what makes something do something. And then to discover that if you try to get answers, that they're related to each other. That the things that make the wind make the waves, and the motion of water is like the motion of air, is like the motion of sand. The fact that things have common features turns out more and more universal. What we're looking for is how everything works, and how everything, what makes everything work. But it's curiosity as to where we are, what we are. It's very much more exciting to discover we're on a ball, half of it sticking upside down. It's spinning around in space. It's a mysterious force which holds us on. It's going around a great big glob of gas that's burning by a fuel, by a fire that's completely different than the fire, any fire we can make. Well, now we can make that fire, nuclear fire. That's a much more exciting story to many people than the tales which other people used to make up who worried about the universe, that we were living on the back of a turtle or something like that. They were wonderful stories, but the truth is so much more remarkable. And so what's the pleasure in physics is that, to me, is that as it's revealed, the truth is so remarkable, so amazing. And I have this disease, and many other people who have studied far enough to begin to understand a little of how things work are fascinated by it. And this fascination drives them on to such an extent that they've been able to convince governments and so on to keep supporting them in this investigation that the race is making into its own environment.
There's a poem by Longfellow about watching the learned astronomer measuring the stars or something, and he goes out and gazes silently up at the sky. Well, when he gazes silently up at the sky, he sees these little points of light in this blackness. When a scientist gazes silently up at the sky, he sees these enormous suns and galaxies, magnetic fields and the turbulence and the heat and the cold and the molecules in between them in space and endless distances and great mysteries. And you have a feeling, if you're a scientist, that you see a lot more.
And this is kind of incredible, because when I'm looking at you, someone standing to my left could see somebody who's standing at my right. That is, the light could be going right across this way. The waves are going this way. The waves are going this way. The waves are going this way. It's just a complete network, so that there's this tremendous mess of waves all over in space, and it's all really there. That's what gets you. But you got to stop and think about it to really get the pleasure about the complexity, the inconceivable nature of nature.
One night I was already asleep, and Richard got permission to wake me up, and I can still remember him at my bed saying, Joan, I want to show you something wonderful. And I got out of bed and we walked down the street to a golf course. And walked out in the middle of the golf course and he said, look up. And there in the sky was an aurora. And he told me that it was an aurora and that nobody knew how they were formed. And I've spent my scientific career studying that. And it was nice of him to give me the aurora and to know that I would think it was wonderful.
I'm going to discuss how we would look for a new law. In general, we look for a new law by the following process. First, we guess it. Then we compute. Well, don't laugh. That's the really true. Then we compute the consequences of the guess to see what, if this is right, if this law that we guess is right, we see what it would imply. And then we compare those computation results to nature. Or we say compare to experiment or experience. Compare it directly with observation to see if it works. If it disagrees with experiment, it's wrong. And that simple statement is the key to science. It doesn't make a difference how beautiful your guess is. It doesn't make a difference how smart you are who made the guess or what his name is. If it disagrees with experiment, it's wrong. That's all there is to it.